Hello to you beautiful people of the African soil. Welcome to another life-changing episode of Soul Impressions. As usual, I'm your host, Moleboheng Matli, better known as Lebo. Today on Soul Impressions, as we normally do, we go into lives of different...
Save me from this cruel man, Lord. I need you to save me. To marry my man, didn't know I'm marrying a man. Sunday morning, I was about to go to church. He told me to choose between him and God.
That is an amazing song. You'll agree with me that not only does she have a beautiful voice, she is stunningly beautiful. An African woman. I like the dress.
Thank you.
Just wore this amazing dress on that.
Makhanda, a man of God indeed, I told you earlier, who has stood the test of time, left the country for many, many years in exile, and he's back home and he's still fulfilling his purpose in God.
Oh, Makhanda, welcome to Soul Impressions.
Amen.
Welcome. And thank you for this time. Please, just to kickstart this exciting one-on-one interview or chat you honored us with, tell me briefly about Samuel Makhanda.
Well, Samuel Makhanda, Caleb, as the name connotes, was born at a very trying time. It just so happened that my mother is also Anna.
Wow.
And she got betrothed to my father, and it took quite some years before I could come into this realm. And consequently, I was...
Finally, here I am seated quite comfortably with Tembi Silentaka. I'm sure you cannot wait to hear her, the melody of her voice, the sonorous voice of young woman. Tembi, welcome to Soul Impressions. I'm
thank
so
you.
Happy to have you.
So,
so honored.
Thank you so much.
Finally, I managed to get you to sit down with me. I've been
thank
trying.
You, thank you. I'm so sorry.
No, it is well. To just start this exciting conversation with you, tell me about Tembi Sile, who she is, where she comes from, and what is she really, truly about?
Well, Tembi Sile, first of all, she's a mother. You know, a mother of two, the 12-year-old and 9-year-old. Tembi Sile is an artist. I'm one of the young South African artists who came through Pop Stars 2003, and now I've got my two albums. The first one is titled, self-titled Tembi Sile, and then this one is called My Journey.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, and I'm here, and I'm enjoying myself. Thank you. My relationship with God, it's such a very long story.
Yeah.
I mean, God has been on my side ever since I was born. I'm sure ever since, I mean, even before I was even formed.
Mm.
And I've got the blessings from Him since I could actually talk, I could open my eyes, I could smile, I could walk. And I'm thankful for the things that He's done for me. I mean, the fact that I'm breathing, I'm here, I'm with you guys.
Yeah.
You know, that's one of the blessings that mm-hmm. I've got. And then also He's been the man that I inform every time I wake up. I'm like, okay, now what am I going to do today?
You inquire from
him. Would you bless
me
in everything that I'm going to be doing today? And then bless me when I come home as well and still be in one piece. Because, I mean, I believe that He's there for everything.
So you've got a one-on-one relationship with Him. You basically depend on Him for everything in your life.
Everything, every decision.
Yeah. The most striking thing that you just reminded me about, I'm sure our viewers would recall this pretty face from the Pop Stars, you know, having said that, you did that in back in 2003.
Yeah.
You know, when the group, I believe, went for a while.
Yeah.
And you all established in your different careers, be it in music or anything.
Yes.
You're still standing in music.
Yeah.
You know, tell me about the journey between the time, you know, actually before you became a pop star and the life after up until today.
Well, oh my goodness, when I entered Pop Stars, I was still in school, I was in high school. I remember I was doing grade 11 at the time, and from there I was just a normal girl from next door, and then Pop Stars came in 2003, I remember, and I said, you know what, I want to have my own thing. Pop Stars came in, it was like a done deal.
Yeah.
I had to go through the auditions and do the Pop Stars so that I'd be able to do what I wanted to do. So when I did Pop Stars, it was all a matter of timing.
Yep.
Because I remember I entered in 2002, never made it, never even went to the place, didn't find the place, like literally didn't find the place,
the
and we were going back home.
Yeah.
And 2003, everything just made sense. So for me, I could safely say that, you know what, I think in 2003 it was my time, just as Tembi Sile let you come out to the people, and then after that, do her own thing, even after the Pop Stars group. Tembi Sile made a promise. This was between, you know, my mother was just delivered girls and girls. And then, you know, my mother said, this time that you're going to give me a boy. And my mother was like, I am telling you, baby,
it is
everything
a boy.
Looks like I'm going to get a boy. And then the next thing, it was a girl. And he's like, now, what are we going to call it? And my mother's like, still, let's call it Tembi Sile, because it was
promise. Yeah.
Even though it's a girl, but it's okay.
And got it a divine
a
appointment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And fortunately for my father, I mean, I was his boy at home. Everyone knows that Tembi Sile was a daddy's girl.
The strong character
everything.
Also.
You know, everything was so boyish. It was only me and my father. So my father never really treated me like a girl. Only my aunts treated me like a girl. Until now, I'm still shaving my head because that's what he made me do.
And you look stunning.
You know?
Quite African, I should say. Thank you,
Baba,
at home for making her shave her head.
You know, and I mean, I've always grown up as a daddy's girl. I was very close to my father, you know, since my mother passed away when I was only 7 years old. So like my father wanted a boy and the boy didn't come out, it just came the girl, and the girl was taking care of him until the passing. So I'm fine with that.
You know, you said that the promise.
Yeah.
What would you consider to be God's promise fulfilled in your life? Because I believe we all live predestined lives.
Yeah.
It's no accident. It is no accident that you came out a girl.
Mm-hmm.
He had a purpose with that.
Yes.
But what is the one area of your life you can look at and said, yes, this is the promise God kept with the life He blessed me with?
He kept his promises from the things that I wanted, the things that I wanted to do for family. His promise to teach. There's this song, you know, that we do in church that said, give me your whole being.
Instead of telling
me
about...
And I will give you everything.
Give me your whole being and I'll give you everything.
Yeah.
It will make more sense coming from you if you sang that. That will be more balanced for me. Just a little bit of it, you know, with Utembi Sile saying
it. But that's the thing. The thing is, maybe some people do not understand it's in Zulu,
it is
guys.
Okay. I can still explain. Viewers, the song means that give me your whole and I will bless you with everything. There, I've just told them, now go and shoot.
It goes. Anginako angi nako ogwanele gi.
Mm-hmm. I love this one. But now let's talk, let's reverse a bit, go back to the pop stars.
Yes.
I could still recall you so well.
Yeah,
you were wearing
recall.
A spot, you know, I don't forget, right up till here, very shy, you know, and looking at you now, you are a grown woman.
Yes.
You know, apart from the fact that you're a mother of two now, back then you were a mother of one, you've just changed so much. I can see that the glow that I believe, of course, it will come with the doors that have opened, but I believe it has to do more with God.
Of course.
You know, what is the one area that you can look at and say, between then and now, you've seen God walk so closely with you? Your first album, I believe, was called Tembi Sile.
Yeah,
and The Promise. Mm-hmm. Tell me about that, the album itself.
Oh, my goodness. Self-titled Tembi Sile. It was all about me. You know, when I came out of the industry, when I came out of the group, all eyes were on me. They were like, oh my goodness, do you think this girl is going to crack it? I don't think so. And a lot of people, obviously, maybe they thought so. But you know what? All they said was, we'll see. And I was saying to myself,
well,
I've got God on my side.
Yes.
We'll see too. Who's bigger? You know what they say, that what doesn't happen to the people, but with God, it happens.
Exactly.
You know, anything is possible with
and
him.
Greater and is he was in you than any other factor
everything.
Surrounding you.
Exactly. Everything. And I was so blessed. I mean, I'm not going to lie to you, because I remember the first time when I went to Durban, everyone was like, we didn't know that you can actually do this on your own. I mean, we didn't know that for the first artist as young as you, coming out of a group, you can sell more than 25,000 copies. Said, you know, you are blessed. And when the timing is right, everything is just going to happen. Everything is just going to go in like a puzzle. It's going to fit like a puzzle.
It's going to fit. Is it all God's glory?
Always lived everything to him.
For
so
him.
I know that everything that is happening into my life is through him.
And tell me your favorite track on Tembi Sile.
Tembi Sile, the self-titled, the first album.
Your favorite music video there.
I think it's Save Me.
Save Me.
Save Me, I think it's the best video ever. And I'm sure they are enjoying it already. Save Me is the best song.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And what brought about Save Me?
Well, I was speaking to my producer, Chico Twala, and we were just talking about the things that are happening, you know, in the industry and things that are happening around where we live and the township and everything. Mm-hmm. And I was like telling him, I'm like, you know what? I so wish that one day I could get God's eyes, you know, and not get, you know, the normal eyes that I already have. Because I want to know what is happening in other people's
see
houses.
Through
I want to see everything. I want to experience things that have never been experienced, because I'm having a problem with a lot of things, especially with the beating of the women. That's when the video came out. That is why it says save me. Because like there's so many people
abused all over,
you know, like going through so much in the evenings, at night, in early hours of the morning.
When everybody else is asleep.
Yeah, and no one sees that stuff. But when I remember when we started the song, we were talking about, can you imagine a man beats you up and then you wake up, you know, in the morning and you put makeup on, you like act fun, you know, you're like, oh, I'm fine, you know. Everyone is busy talking about stuff, and you're like, no, I'm good.
You have to keep it up and putting yourself together.
And only to find out that you're actually not living a good life.
Mm-hmm.
So only you can actually speak to him who can change your life.
And that's God himself.
It's all about telling him everything. Mm-hmm. It's all about informing him of everything. So I guess if you do that, everything makes that is why the video came about. God saved me, my mother saved me, he saved me. I wish I listened before I could do things. I wish I
could have been saved better. Well, do enjoy the next coming music video from her self-titled album, Tembi Sile, and the song is Save Me. Do enjoy.
Tembisile, you actually have a second album now,
yes,
right?
Father? This one is much grown album, and I am singing my lungs out. I'm doing what I want to do. I love doing gospel. I love doing Afro soul.
Yes.
I love, you know, talking about the things that anyone out can relate.
Mm-hmm.
I want to talk about something that is educative to someone,
yeah,
out there. And on this second album, I'm doing exactly that.
Yeah.
And what is perfect about this album is the fact that I got time. You know, last time I released an album, it was 2.5 years,
yeah,
ago, and now I had so much time to actually prepare.
To focus,
yeah,
and take it out the way you want it to be received.
Yeah, you know? And also this type doing it live.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole album is done live in the studio.
Lovely.
So I'm just hoping that people are going to enjoy the music,
mm-hmm,
but at the same time get something from
it. Is it the journey?
Yes, that's the journey. And I feel like, you know, this time I think a lot of people are going to relate, including married people, single people, young people.
It covers all zones.
Yeah, it covers all zones, but mostly, you know, it just talks about my journey and the things that I believe in and the things that people believe in. And
yeah,
that's the reason why I'm always saying that I love to be on stage and sing a song and someone can say, but I'm going through the same,
yes,
thing, you,
yeah,
know. And for me, it makes me feel like I'm doing something different, because now when you leave the show, you're gonna be like, you know what? I think I'm gonna rethink my,
yeah,
decision, you know. And I think that's what I'm supposed to do anyway.
Yeah, yeah. You know, half the time I've realized that you being associated so much with a late diva, Brenda Fassie, tone,
yes,
the strength and everything. Yeah. You know, looking at your background, also referring to the pop stars.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you came from humbling beginnings.
Yes,
and God has lifted you quite much. I remember back then where they showed your village and these kids were running behind the cars.
Oh, no idea.
And you're still very, very humble.
It was so hectic.
Under normal circumstances, a person gets a breakthrough that I believe only comes through God.
Yeah.
But then they forget who they are, where they come from, what are they really all about. And they move to Johannesburg and everything,
yeah,
has changed. And you are so, so humble. Does your humbleness have anything to do with your relationship with God? Because you're still the same Tembisile.
As I said before, I have one-on-one with him, you know, and everything that I believe with me, it comes through him and from him, you know, and I believe that where I'm coming from, I think, shaped me to be the person that I am. And also being raised by a man, a poor man,
yeah,
you know, who's got nothing to give you that is so material,
exactly,
but he can only give you the things...
The basics.
Yeah,
the something basics much deeper.
Something that is much deeper, something that you can never buy it anyway.
Yeah.
You know, and for me, that says I'm blessed. I'm more than just blessed, because I was never raised with the silver spoon. So in a way, I've got to be humble. I've got to
And you
do
cherish
my
everything
best
that comes your
to
way.
To make sure that his word and his name
is glorified to your
glorified
life.
More than the Tembisile, because I believe that God works through people.
Mm.
So if I'm singing, praise the Lord, all my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy, holy name. You see, it's me singing, but
it
someone
comes from
else
the heart
that is actually, you know, watching
relate
me,
with that.
They relate to me, because I believe that he speaks through me with the stuff that I do, the music that I do, the voice.
Wow.
You know what? I believe that, you know, we are so fortunate to have voices, because you sing in front of millions. Imagine if you sing that song and someone is, you know, they have a certain problem, they have certain something, but they know that there's someone above everything,
exactly,
above it all, and they're going to make it happen for them. So I'm just so, you know, I'm so blessed to have everything.
Without a mom, you lost your mom when you were 7.
Yes.
And God has honored and blessed you so much. Parenthood,
yeah,
is a blessing from God. Regardless of the circumstances and situations, uh-huh, kids are born.
Yeah.
It is the will of God, because,
yeah,
he is the one that giveth life.
Yes.
You're a mother of 2,
mm-hmm,
and having grown up without one, how do you relate to your kids, you know, and...
They enjoy being with me. They enjoy being... I'm a funny mom, you know.
A relaxed mom.
Yeah, like I'm a very talkative mom.
Yeah.
And I mean, they hate the fact that sometimes I would ask them, what happened in school today?
Mm-hmm.
Like, mommy, but we haven't even eaten yet.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
You know? I get them from school. I'm like, so guys, what happened today?
Yeah.
Ah. Wait for us to eat and then we'll talk. And I think that's one of the things that I've been trying to do, you know, since I was never with a mom by my side, who was always my father. Yeah. I'm trying my best to give my kids the best things that I can.
Yeah, and some of the things also, you also did not have.
You know, like, I'm trying my best, you know. Raising kids is not an easy job, hey? I just found that out now.
Yeah, and on your own, again, can't be easy.
It's not easy at all. I mean, okay.
And the society puts so much pressure. The industry you're in, alone, Tembi, requires you to travel so much.
Yeah.
And being a mother of two, those young ones are a handful already, you know, including your studies, I believe. You also busy studying.
Yeah.
How do you juggle everything together to still strike
it's
a balance and maintain
scheduling.
That relationship with God?
I mean, it's all about scheduling stuff. Today I'm working, tomorrow I'm with the kids, the other day I'm doing a gig, and then after that I'm
You're
trying
writing
to
exams
do the
or something.
I'm always doing things around my family, because it's like now I wish you could see my kids, because I'm sure they wanted to come.
Yeah.
You know, but you know, it's been raining and I've been running up and down, so you know, it's all about juggling things.
Yes.
And also being professional in everything that you do. Know the time, separate the time. When it's time for kids, it's time for kids.
Yeah.
If it's time for work, it's time for work. And that's how I've been doing it. And also having the mothers, guys, you know, I'm raised by beautiful women. Guys from church, I love you. I love you. Mom Dube, everyone, I love them. Because sometimes I would travel, especially when I do promotions. Promotions, you never come home. Maybe you'll come home after 4 or 5 days.
Yeah.
It depends where you're going, because you're trying to, you know, to go everywhere.
Yeah.
And sometimes when you're doing the tour, you come after 2 weeks, or you come home for 1 day, and then the following day
again.
You're leaving, you know. So I'm so glad to have such wonderful women in my church. And also, you know, to someone close to me, they're helping me a lot.
Wow.
And I think I'm blessed to not have a mother, but at the same time,
God has provided the motherhood around
me,
you.
You know, and I'm fine and I'm not complaining.
Don't complain, because you won't be happy. What would you consider at this moment to be a wow? I understand you've worked with quite a lot of artists. You've collaborated with big artists like Uringo.
Yeah.
Or you're busy with Ntando.
Yeah.
There's quite a lot that you're busy with that's happened. Is there one particular area you can look at and say it's a wow moment?
For me, my wow moment... Well, I think me, Rebecca, and Ringo doing a song on stage.
Yeah.
That was a biggie for me. That was the biggest moment
ever.
I know that I've worked with a lot of artists. Don't be mad. I know you. I've worked with a lot of artists, but I think one of my biggest wow moments, to have dinner with Mandela on the same table, sharing a joke.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, thinking where I'm coming from, I'm like, oh God, you are great.
You know?
Oh God, you are beautiful.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm thinking so many people come across the world just to meet him, and they never even get to sit down with him. They can only shake
his
hand.
And you're so honored.
And I'm sitting with him and I'm eating with him, and I'm like, I like this thing.
Yeah.
You know, I think I like it. You know,
so
I
your
like
moment
this.
With Madiba was an honor from God.
For me, that was like,
wow, definitely it would be for anyone else, I believe, because he's a man of stature.
Yes.
And there are many young people, Tembi, out there, you know, who want to be where you are, who come from families that can't afford. What is the one thing that you can say needs to be done in instilling discipline in young people? Young people will remain young people, you know, challenges will be there within families and the society. But what is the characteristic or one attribute that you think is very, very important to path a child into becoming who they are?
You know, there's so many things that I always want to say when it comes to that. But I can only say, because of what happened to me, I know when you're telling a young person to wait, and you're not just waiting, you're waiting in prayer. I'm thinking, I did that for 21 years, and it was not nice. It was not, you know, it was unbearable. It was not easy.
You can imagine.
But now, the time was perfect. And it was my time. And God was like, now I'm here. So I would ask if you guys out there would wait, but not just wait, wait in prayer. You wait there in your space, so that when your blessing come, it finds you in that space. Don't move in that space, because the minute you move, you'll miss your blessing, and then at the end of the day, you'll be telling people that God doesn't exist and it's all your fault. I did that for 21 years and it worked for me.
Powerful. A woman of wisdom, I see.
Yeah.
Definitely rooted in the word.
That's what I did.
You know, we're born for a purpose. You mentioned so many things. You're a mother, you're an artist, you this, you that. What do you consider to be your main purpose on earth? That when God said, I'm bringing Tembi down to earth, what was his intention?
because of my voice, because of the things that I say, mm-hmm. because of the people that I come across, and they say things that I said on TV or the things that I sing about on the album, mm-hmm. I think I'm here to serve. It's not about me. It's not about you.
It's about changing lives.
It's just about me trying to make someone's life out there better. It's about me trying to make someone out there say, you know what, I think I'm okay. If I'm poor and I'm sleeping on the floor for the past 21 years,
I can accept it.
I'm fine.
It will get better.
Yeah, because you know what? At the end of the day, he's going to come and he's going to pick me up and put me up there and no one will ever believe it.
Wow.
Just like the way he did with me. So that is why I can't talk about something that I don't know. I need to talk about things that happened to me.
You've experienced yourself.
Yes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
And how do you keep your spirit and your soul purified through all these challenges, HIV and AIDS? You spoke about something quite hectic, you know, and very, very emotional also, which grabs attention at this point in time. Women and children abuse, you know, we've got domestic violence almost everywhere. How do you manage to still keep your spirit and your soul purified and connected to God despite the challenges? Because it's only no matter sometimes you'll get discouraged.
Yeah.
You watch TV, a baby's been raped. There's so much happening.
Yeah. This is what we always say in church. Your knees needs to be the connection. They are the connection to everything. When you kneel down, when you pray, that's when you're going to see things happen for you, for your life, for
your children,
someone next to you, for your kids, for your great-grandchildren. This, we even say that let them be
black
spots all over, because this is the only connection.
Yeah.
And for me, this is the connection that calms me down, that makes me see things differently, because I ask for things.
Mm-hmm.
And then when they happen, they happen because I do this.
And you still go back to this to say thank you.
Thank you. Exactly.
It's been so awesome, awesome
thank
spending this
so
time
much.
With you,
thank
Sese.
You
I believe that need a follow-up. There's a whole lot much more
I would
to
love
talk
it if
about.
You, call me.
You know, we would need you to come
Hopefully
back.
Next time I'll call my kids. I'm like, kids, come.
You're definitely a loving mother. In closing, just speak to the young people all over Africa, you know, mothers, women, brothers, fathers.
Yeah.
A message from your heart in this year of 2009.
Oh, 2009 is so beautiful. I think it's bringing a lot of changes to a lot of people. And everyone is talking about this big nine being a lucky number. So I'm hoping for everyone out there that 2009 is the year of breakthroughs. You tell yourself, you know what? Me being broke doesn't belong to me. Me being tired of not getting things doesn't belong to me. It belongs to someone else. And also to the woman. If you don't respect yourself, your children, your neighbors, your church members, your worker, your colleagues at work will never ever respect you. To the man, we respect you. We're not trying to be like you. So please treat us like the way we deserve to be treated. And also, don't abuse us. God bless you.
Let us not go back into the interview because
you
won't finish. That is all we have for you on Soul Impressions this week. I'm sure you have been inspired by a true story of Tembi Sile, a young woman truly who has been tested, who was humbled at a very young age, grew up without a mother, only raised by a dad who had not much, but she still trusted in God and used these, as she said, to connect with God. And today she's a living testimony that no matter what happens, no matter where you are, all things are possible with God. And as I always say, it matters not how you relate to him. You call him Allah, you call him Jesus, you call him God. He is alive. He is for you. He is for me. He is for Africa. He is for the world. Until we meet again on another life-changing episode of Soul Impressions, stay blessed. Having mentioned the name Tembi Sile, what is the meaning of the name Sile? And having said all this, tell me about your relationship with him. Who is God in Tembi Sile's life?
But now I needed a stepping stone for me. So
people in different genres of life, and we are honored by the presence of Tembi Sile Ndaka, a young woman who's gone through the test of time, but she's still standing strong in her career as a musician, a mother, and so much more. But well, do discover for yourself in the next coming few moments. Do enjoy Tembi Sile Ndaka.
From this cruel man, Lord, I need you to save me. Oh, save me. from this madman. Mama, mama, warn me about this man of mine. She said, baby, take time to mourn him.
Didn't listen to mama.
I went straight to church and married my man. Still on soul impressions. And yes, I entered finally.
Named Samia. Yes,
quite yeah. Prophetic.
Amen, amen. And really, I should say that ever since I could remember, I lived in the house of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
And thanks God, the house where we were was just almost 50 meters away from the church. So all my life was in the house of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
Then I went to school at St. John's Anglican in the early 40s. And then went to school, or high school, I went to Orlando High.
That's in Soweto.
In Soweto, oh, yes. Orlando High in Soweto. And after Soweto, I went to Orlando West High, which also made in 1976.
Yes.
And I did my JC at Orlando West High. So I went to, for my matric, I went to Ngamana in Natal. And I should say that when I was with the Anglicans at St. John's, I became an Anglican. And then when I went over to Ngamana, a Catholic school,
I became a Catholic.
I became a Catholic.
An all-rounder.
Amen, amen. And it was in the Catholic school that I decided to be a priest.
When God brought me into the United Nations, where I was for 10 years, as the Special Committee Against Apartheid, I then met with Bishop John. And as I was saying, it was in the natural, it was by accident.
Yes.
But spiritually, it was divine. A design. Yeah,
yes.
Amen, amen. I got in there, running away from the weather, and sat in this group of 10, 15 people in a hotel, the Doral Inn, just opposite the World of Astoria Inn. The first day I got into a prophetic there. And there was a service going on. And then at the end of the I just slipped in.
Mm-hmm.
I was getting away from the weather, just slipped in, and because it was a hotel and a service, they couldn't chase me.
God actually set you up.
It was a setup, indeed. Absolutely, it was a setup. So getting in there, at the end of the service, the pastor at the time, the prophet says, my brother, can I pray with you? I say, yes. He says, can you come forward? I said, yes. So he says, lift up. He says, are you born again? I said, oh, yes. He says, lift up your hands. I lifted up my hands. And the Lord spoke. Oh, he spoke.
Clearly.
Oh, yes. He spoke through the prophet. And that day, I knew. I've been believing in God.
Yes.
But that day, I did not believe in God. I knew God.
Wow.
I knew God because there was no way. Bishop Jordan is younger than myself. To start with. Secondly, he had never been outside of United States, Africa, into Africa or something like that. Even if he was out of Africa, he wouldn't have known me. The things that he said, only myself could know. That's, like I say, that day I knew God. But what was very interesting is that later, within the job, that God was telling me what he was going to do with me in the United Nations. God was going to tell me, in actual fact, one of the things the Lord said was that through the prophet said, do you have a passport? The prophet asking the prophet, my brother, do you have a passport? God says, do you have a passport? And I figured, come on, I'm a refugee and all that.
Yeah.
What do I do with a passport and everything? I said, no, I don't have a passport. I couldn't travel from point A to point B.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, passport, do you have to be, do you have money? Then the prophet said, God says, he is going to send you to every corner of the world. Oh my God, I figured, oh, come on. You know, this fellow just wants to say something and everything. But in time, God fulfilled exactly that.
When it manifested, it came fully.
Yes. You know, I didn't have a job. I was a refugee. I didn't have an income. But God literally sent me through every corner of the world. I've been to every corner of the five continents. Not only that, the invitations I got and getting there, I never traveled economy. It was business class. God is awesome.
He's the provider, Jehovah Jireh.
He is real. He's real. Very real. At the United Nations now, we were two of us, me and another young fellow. Now, in order to sustain our office, embassies need 40, 20, 30 people and everything. But, and God did say, you see, I am going to make sure, you are going to know me, because every meeting that you are going to be part of, I will tell you ahead of time what's going to be happening. I will bring the people that you need to meet with. Now, if anybody, you know, anybody can check it, you know, in the internet and all the records of the United Nations. That's the thing, God, you know, most of the ambassadors used to ask, you know, I mean, you are only two you guys in the office. How are you able to do A, B, C?
To function and, fully and be so efficient in everything.
Yes. And as I say, you know, as you correctly point out, to function just with the General Assembly alone.
Yes.
You know, like I say, most embassies don't have less than 10 people.
Mm.
Yes. And here were we two. We had to get into the Security Council. There were times when the Lord, I'll go to two meetings. I'll go into one meeting. I'd sit there for a meeting, and the Holy Spirit says, jump up. And I'll jump. Send me the second meeting. I'll be sitting there, and in that second meeting, and the Holy Spirit will be saying exactly what has been going on.
Wow.
Chairman would ask a question. Oh, anybody want to say anything? And kind of, I lift up my hand. Everybody, look, he's crazy, that one. He just walked in. What is he going to say? Yes. And the Holy Spirit would come through and everything. To the extent that, you know, most of those people, most of those people, outside they'd come, but you're not in and everything. And I'd say it as the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
That's how the Lord used, you know, God uses many ways to demonstrate himself.
And any way.
And
he even said if he must use stones to be worshipped, he will do
indeed.
That.
Yes, indeed. You see? So, you know, as I said, that's when I really came, not to believe God, but to know him.
And in closing, you know, having been part of the politics back then, one or the other will always be, our history has made us who we are. I always say we need to celebrate our history. It has formed who we are today, and we have what we have. We wouldn't have what we have in actual fact had not certain things happened. I would like you to address Africa, our leaders, having been there. What is it that can be done to make this Africa better? And how do we keep the fear of God and honor him with our lives despite the passion we may have for our careers?
Amen. Yes. Amen. You know, prophetically, God's priority in this season is Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And people of African descent. It is not by mistake that you have in America Obama, who's one generation only away.
Mm.
God is having Africa on his program. African, you know, African leader, and thanks God, again, like I say, you know, God sent me to all, most of these African leaders and things like that. And some, for instance, like when Cote d'Ivoire, when Cote d'Ivoire, God prophesied. And thanks God, the leadership of Cote d'Ivoire, the president and the wife and his wife are believers.
Amen.
And they believe God's word when we gave them the word. Now, you see, what God is doing this day is raising the marginalized, raising the despised, raising the ones that were shunted out.
Yes.
And Africans have been that. So it behooves African leaders to understand that, you know, it is God that raises nations.
Yes.
It is God that brings them down.
Amen.
Yes. And you know, whatever they do has to be in line with what God does. And what is that might be in line? You see, African leaders need to be there for the people.
Mm-hmm.
African leaders need to be there for justice. African leaders need to be there for development.
Mm-hmm.
You see, one of the biggest sins is poverty. Poverty is a sin. And it being a sin, God came, Jesus came to get us out of sin, which means Jesus came to get us out of poverty.
Mm-hmm.
And as long as leaders do not do things towards empowering, do things towards making the people, each and every yes. person, have a roof top of his or her head, have enough to eat in the stomach and everything, have no diseases, have schools. As long as they don't do that, they're not doing God's work.
Mm-hmm.
And that is why we will always have conflict, we'll always have wars.
Yes.
Yes. So African leaders need to understand that God directs their program.
Mm-hmm.
If they do what God wants, money will come.
Mm.
Riches
answers
will come.
Come.
Yes. Some of them, you know, who are, who have been thinking that they want to amass money, they don't even enjoy that money.
Mm.
They don't enjoy that money. Because God says, silver and gold are his.
Mm.
And it is. It's God's silver. So African leaders have to understand one thing. African leaders have to take care of the African people.
Mm-hmm.
African leaders have to make sure that children go to school, got good schools.
Mm.
That, you know, our people have hospitals. That our people have decent houses. Africa is a big continent. Its land is great. It's wealthy.
Mm.
And as long as leaders have got that view, God will be on their side. And as God says, he raises leaders, he brings them down.
Mm.
So this is what African leaders need to be doing.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much for this time.
Amen.
Baba, in this year of 2009, may the Lord increase you. May he increase your ministry. May he increase this vision. And certainly, I believe that African people have heard this word, and there is much more, I believe, that you still need to take out, because your life is a living testimony that God is a God of purpose.
Yes.
And today I realize the importance of giving our children meaningful names.
Amen.
I believe your life Amen. Is just a mouthpiece of the actual name you're bearing. Good Lord bless
Amen.
You.
God bless you. Amen. Have a blessed day.
Thank you. Well, you will agree with me that has been quite insightful, quite educational, but mostly very humbling to realize that we've got very powerful people sitting right next to us, but you would not recognize them because of the humbleness that is resembles the character of Christ in us. Bishop Makhanda is a man of many, many talents, but he's chosen to stand and fulfill his purpose in God. May you be blessed, Africans, as he said that we need to stand, and our leaders, there's a lot of work to be done in making this continent as beautiful as it ever could be. Until we meet on another life-changing episode of Salt Impressions, I'm Moleboheng Matli, and stay blessed. you.
I wish I came out.
Over to me. I would. But now tell me about after